Hello and welcome to this lesson, which focuses on Area of Study 1, the Western classical tradition from 1650 to 1910. In this session, we're going to look at Mozart's clarinet concerto as an introduction. Why are we doing this? Because we have to. AQA tell us. But actually, there's a better reason. Mozart is often referred to as the greatest composer of all time. So it would be silly not to look at somebody like Mozart, how he writes, and his style. Ofqual, a number of years ago, said that all students doing GCSE music must study a classical composer or a classical piece if they are to take a GCSE. And this section will appear in section B on your written exam and your listening exam in June. So pay attention. So let's start looking at Mozart and his life. Often referred to as the greatest composer of all time, but also the greatest composer in the classical period. Hopefully, you have spent a bit of time looking at classical music, the features, the characteristics, the dates. Another name that you might associate with Mozart is Haydn. Now, Haydn influenced Mozart and vice versa. They did actually meet each other and were friends. So, he was born in Salzburg, which looks very pretty. I'm not sure if many of you have been to Salzburg. It's the place where The Sound of Music is filmed. And he died in Vienna at the young age of 35. And sadly, Mozart died a very poor man and at a young age. He was from a very, very musical family. And him and his sister were what we would call child prodigies. And his dad thought it's a great opportunity to make a little bit of money. So there, poor old young Mozart was made to tour quite extensively around Europe, as this high quality animation depicts. So him and his sister went around Europe, did actually make it to London, okay, and he did a tour around there. It did actually take its toll on Mozart and make him quite ill, probably explain why he died at such a young age, because he had so many late nights performing in front of the celebrities at the time. A little bit of trivia about Mozart. Mozart, naughty Mozart, once visited the Sistine Chapel. Now, the Sistine Chapel is the very, very holy, sacred place in Rome, okay, where the Pope would go and celebrate his services. Now, a lot of the music that's sung in the Vatican City, in the Sistine Chapel, is in fact not allowed to be sung by any other choirs. And at the time, Mozart heard a very special piece of music, which you should be able to hear in the background, called Allegri's Miserere, which is often performed on Good Friday. Now, this wonderful piece of music was so special that nobody was allowed the music for it. Now, because Mozart was such a genius, he went to this service twice and listened to this piece of music and wrote it down from his memory following that service, or both of those services. So there we go, that's a bit of trivia about Mozart and Allegri's Miserere. It's a good pub quiz question. Also, it's used in the film Face Off.
Domini Nostri Jesu Christi, et caritas Dei, et communicatio Sancti Spiritus, sit cum omnibus vobis, et cum spiritu tuo. Fratres, agnoscamus peccata nostra, ad sacra mysteria celebranda, qui missus, sanare quatritus corde, Kyrie eleison, qui peccatores vocare venisti, Christe eleison, qui de dextra patri sedes, ad inter flandum pro nobis, Kyrie eleison. Rater nostri omnipotens Deus, dimisi peccatis nostris, perducat nos ad vitam aeterna. Amen.
Thank you.
So how much music did Mozart actually write? And what sort of pieces were they? Well, let's take a look. So despite touring extensively, Mozart did find the time to write a huge number of pieces. Far too many for me to mention right now, but you'll notice that following each piece of music, there is a K. Okay, and this refers, or a KV, this refers to the Kirchhill number. It's basically a catalogue, because he wrote so much, it helps people put them into different sections. So he wrote symphonies from an early age. It's quite a large number of symphonies there. Going into 30-odd, keeping going, 40, 41. Piano concertos. Now, you will remember that a concerto is a piece of music which features a solo instrument, in this case, a piano, showcasing the skills and techniques used on those instruments. Violin concerto, horn concerto, woodwind concerto. Not only that, he wrote loads of music for piano. He wrote loads of music for chamber orchestras, which are basically small mini orchestras. He wrote huge numbers of music for the stage, string quartets too. Now, stage music is often called operas. And when I find it, which I'm still trying to do now because it's so far down this list, he wrote loads of church music as well. There we go. Huge amounts of church music. He was paid to write church music. Also paid by the court to write music for them. Organ music, brilliant. Now, he wrote opera. Now, a lot of his opera is what people love the most, and he wrote some of the greatest operas in history. So, to answer the question, Mozart wrote loads. What resources were available to Mozart at the time? What instruments could he write for? Well, his orchestra was a standard classical orchestra, which looked like so. Now, you can see I've bracketed the woodwind family, the brass family, and the string family. The string family is obviously the biggest, okay? And the woodwind is then the second biggest, and the brass was still in its infancy. I've put an arrow pointing to the horns, and I want you to look at what it says here, clarinets in A. I will explain about that later and in a bit more detail. The clarinet concerto is split into three movements. Okay, and we're going to look at Rondo, which is the final movement. Now, that's a very sad picture of Mozart on writing music on his deathbed. Well, he didn't write this on his deathbed, but it was certainly in his final year of his life. It's right at the end of his very prolific music career. Now, that is a picture of a modern-day clarinet. Some of you might play a clarinet, or have at least seen one. And you can see it's got a complicated set of keys. It's a woodwind instrument, which has got a wooden reed at the top, and air is blown into it. And when you put your fingers on these keys, it changes the length of the column of air. Okay, a bit of physics. Therefore, the frequency will change, and the pitch that comes out will be different depending on the length of the column of air. Don't have to worry about that too much, but what we do need to think about was that the clarinet was actually quite a young instrument when Mozart wrote for it. Okay? And before that was this instrument called a basset horn, which, I don't know about you, I think probably could win the competition for being the most grotesque and ugly instrument ever invented. Anyway, that was what was around when Mozart started thinking about writing music for a clarinet. Now, a modern-day basset horn has still existed. It's marginally better looking, but you can see it looks like a clarinet, but it's obviously going to be a lot lower because it's got that little bit of a bass extension at the bottom. This is what modern clarinet, these are what early clarinets look like. Okay, that looks a little bit like a cross between a recorder and a modern-day clarinet. And you'll notice there are three different sizes there. That's quite an important point I want you to remember. So the instruments come in different sizes. There are three registers on a clarinet, and in the following clip, the lady will explain what those registers are called and how they sound different. You will need to know this as part of your GCSE Section B listening paper. It will be referred to, and it will be something that you're expected to talk about with confidence.
Hi, I'm Vrucha Trivedi with the Virtual Clarinet Academy. Today I want to talk to you all a little bit about the different registers of the clarinet. I think that there are three main registers, but I kind of break them down into sub-registers as well. So the main registers of the clarinet that you're going to hear maybe your band director or your private teacher talk about are the Shalumeau register, the clarion register, and the altissimo register. So let's start down low with the Shalumeau register. So the Shalumeau is actually, it's a French word. The Shalumeau was actually an instrument that was the ancestor to the clarinet. And if you were playing clarinet in like the 1600s, early 1700s, you may have been playing a Shalumeau. And one crazy thing I think about the Shalumeau is that instead of playing with the reed down on our lip, they played like this, which is crazy to me. Like, that kind of tickles my upper lip, actually. But the Shalumeau was played like that, with the reed facing up. On our modern clarinet now, we call that lower register of the clarinet the Shalumeau register, as kind of an homage to the ancestor to our modern clarinet. So let me play a little bit of the Shalumeau register for you. That's all the Shalumeau register. Within the Shalumeau register, we have what is called the throat tones. And maybe you've heard your band director tell you, like, oh, the throat tones are out of tune in the clarinet section. I feel like I always, when I'm trying to play in tune, I'm like, oh, my throat tones are always out of tune. But the throat tones, they start on around F, or thumb F here, and they go all the way up to B flat. And they're called the throat tones because they occur at the throat of the clarinet, like on the upper part of it. And so here are the throat tones of the clarinet. Tend to sound kind of airy. We sometimes have to put down extra fingers that are called resonance fingerings on our right hand, maybe even our left hand, to help with the pitch and help with the sound quality of them, but they occur within that Shalumeau register. Next, we have our clarion register. And the word clarion comes from actually the trumpet. So there's a trumpet that has no valves, so, you know, no, it's just like a natural trumpet. And when the clarinet was invented, when that register key was put on the clarinet and clarinetists were starting to play higher into the next register, I guess somebody heard it and said, oh, that kind of sounds like a little trumpet. It doesn't. I mean, I don't think it does, but that name stuck. And so the next register of the clarinet that we have is called the clarion register. So I'm going to start on my B here, thumb register, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, plus pinky, and it goes all the way up to our C here. So that's thumb plus. So here's a little bit of the clarion register. Next, we have our altissimo register, and this is where we start to get pretty high. So the altissimo register, instead of a register key like we have here in the back, we have to actually kind of use a makeshift register key, which is going to be our left-hand index finger here. So we have to lift it up, and that kind of acts as a second register key to get up into the altissimo register. There are going to be notes in the altissimo register where you put your fingers down, where you put your finger down, but for the most part, for the lower altissimo notes, you do need to lift it up to get them to come out properly. So our altissimo register starts on C sharp here, thumb register, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, and it goes up to high G with the side key here. So that's thumb register, 2, plus side key here. Here's a little bit of the altissimo register. So I actually started on low C because, or on C.
So I'd like to have a look at the idea about transposing instruments. Now, if you don't play a woodwind instrument or a brass instrument, you might not really know what this means. It means a few things. You will notice that when we're talking about a clarinet, we normally accompany it with a clarinet in A, or it could be a clarinet in B flat, and sometimes there's even a clarinet in C. So that has a particular reason and meaning behind that. So if you ask a clarinet in A to play the note C, the sound that will actually come out at the end of the clarinet will be an A. Now, that isn't obviously the right note. So in order to counteract that, you have to change the way the music is written down in order for it to match the rest of the orchestra. You don't have to worry why this is the case, but you do have to know and have a bit of an understanding about what this means in practice. So let's look at it in a bit more detail. I hopefully haven't blown your mind too much about this. I'll try and make it as straightforward as possible. So the clarinet in A sounds a third lower than written. We've worked that out because if you asked a clarinet in A to play a C, it will play an A, which is actually three notes lower. Now, it's actually a minor third, okay? So in order to make it play the correct pitches, you have to write all the music a third higher, or a minor third higher. So that little diagram there shows how the notes are written and what the notes that will sound come out of the instrument. Now, that is the same for the horns too. Now, this is something that if you can start understanding and trying to memorize, especially the facts about the differences in pitch and the way it's written down, it will serve you well. It has come up before as an exam question, okay? So it could say something like, why is the clarinet written differently to other instruments? And then an answer might be something like, for a couple of marks, the clarinet is a transposing instrument. It plays a minor third lower than written. Therefore, the key signature is different. Now, remember, the key signature is a little combination of sharps or flats that comes at the very beginning of a piece of music to indicate what the home key is. Because we're shifting that, it will have a different key signature. Okay, so the movement is in A, the clarinet concerto in A major. So the clarinet part needs to be written a minor third higher. Therefore, the clarinet's key signature is C major. Now, that sounds complicated, but if you go back and listen to what I've said in the previous section, it should make sense. So we're going to look at now the classical concerto. Now, I've already explained that a concerto is a piece of music which showcases off a solo instrument, or in the early form of the concerto, a group of instruments. This is obviously a clarinet concerto. Therefore, the thing that is taking the main limelight is the clarinet, which, is, remember, was a pretty new invention of an instrument. So there are three movements to a concerto, whereas a symphony would normally have four. So a concerto has three. We're looking at the last movement. The allegro is the way it starts. It starts quickly. A contrasting slow movement, normally in a minor key, and a rondo is something to finish it off. Hopefully you remember what a rondo is, but I normally use the idea of a Big Mac, or in this case, a vegan Big Mac. What does that mean? Well, you'll notice the thing that makes a Big Mac so unique is this sort of extra layer of bread in the middle. So in terms of music, if the music was to start with this layer of bread, the one with the seeds on, then we've got this layer here of the vegan burger and the lettuce and the sauce that you'd say is the contrasting B section. And the C section is underneath, but it's sandwiched between that A section again. So we get A, B, A, C, because it's got a bit of cheese on there, back to the A. So hopefully that makes sense. Think of a rondo form a bit like a vegan Big Mac or a regular Big Mac, depending on your preference. I'm not a vegan, by the way. So we're going to look at the theme in a bit more detail. So I've got the music in front of me. Now, this has obviously just got the clarinet part and the violins. Now, at this point, you might say to me, hang on, Mr. Brand, you've just spent a bit of time explaining to us that the clarinet part will be written in a different key. But I can see that it's written in the same key. There are three sharps here and there are three sharps there. Yes, that is the case. And the reason is to make it easy. If you were to look at the proper big score, you would see that in fact it would be written down differently. This is just to make it crystal clear for us to understand what is going on. So I'm going to get you to listen to this, and then I'm going to get you to listen in a bit more detail to some of the characteristics and features of this theme. So let's dive straight in and look at some of the features. The first thing you'll know, it is titled Allegro. Now you should know that Allegro means quickly, It's a good fact to know that this is, in fact, a quick piece of music. It's in 6-8. Now, this is important. It means it's compound time. Whereas most music is in 2-4 or 4-4, 6-8 means that the notes are grouped in groups of three, and it has, therefore, a bouncy, lilting feel to it. So most music is either 1-2, 1-2, or 1-2-3-4. These groups then are divided into groups of three. 1-2-3, 1-2-3, 1-2-3. It has a bounce to it, okay? That's a useful thing to know. Also, that the key signature is A major, okay? So this is all quite obvious factual information about Mozart's rondo. Now, looking at the melody that a clarinet plays in a bit of detail, you'll see that it's got a bit of a feature of these three staccato notes. Now, you'll spot them at various points, maybe not always the same notes, but you'll see it's a bit of a pattern coming back. It's useful to memorize bits of information like that. You could get asked about it. Now, the articulation is a really posh word to describe how the notes are played. Are they played smoothly, or are they played detached, short and sharp staccato? Well, he likes a bit of variety, and you can see him using what we call slurred patterns, which is indicated by this slur line, okay, together with this staccato scale here. Now, that adds a bit of variety and a bit of balance. Now, classical composers love balance in their music, so having a group of slurred notes followed by a group of staccato notes is definitely a thing that classical composers like to do. Melody and accompaniment texture. Again, that's a big feature of classical music, to have the main melody played by a solo instrument and these upper strings, the violins and the violas, to play the main accompaniment part. You'll notice that the phrases, okay, are divided into two bars. Now, again, because they like balance in the classical period, it's either going to be two bars or four bars, okay? The main idea is actually divided into two bars, okay? And the second bar being here. So this opening line has two bar phrases, and they're really clear. Okay, now this second bar phrase ends on the dominant. Now, you might need to do a bit of revision about your Roman numerals and what the word dominant means, but in this case, it's a chord of E major. Now, one characteristic, or another characteristic, of classical music is that composers loved the dominant. They love chord five. In fact, they were obsessed with it. And chord one and five had this quite slightly obsessive relationship, which made it very clear and obvious where the cadence was coming. Now, again, if you're not sure what a cadence is, you might have to go back and do a bit of revision. Let's just say it's sort of like the musical or harmonic punctuation that happens at the end of phrases. Listening back to it, the orchestra repeats that idea, but this time there's no clarinet. And Mozart decides to do something a little bit more interesting with the dynamics. Now, this is, again, something which you need to try and memorize. A question could be, what does Mozart do to add variety in terms of the first opening theme? Well, you could say, when it repeats, there is no clarinet. And also, he does the following to the dynamics. Each four-bar phrase starts quietly, but then it gets louder and gets to a loud part, and then after that it goes back to being quiet. So that variety makes the music interesting, okay? And it's a feature of this piece. So I know I've gone through a lot today, but hopefully you'll be able to take away some key points about Mozart, his life, the orchestra that was available to him, the clarinet, the history of the clarinet a little bit, as well as how transposing instruments work. Now, I know that's quite a hard idea, but stick with it. You do need to know it. We looked at how the concerto is put together very briefly, and then we've had a look at the opening theme. We've got stuck into the nitty-gritty about what Mozart does to make that theme so special. I hope you enjoyed it. Thanks. See you next time.